Hi folks, today I'm going to show you the inside and of an electric toothbrush and how it works. It was this old piece of crap. It's about 11 or 12 years old, and this week it died. Even the rubber is going to pieces. I put everything apart, and the cause was the motor part was jammed, and there was a lot of corrosion damage done by the water, and because also the seals were not very good anymore, and the diode, the charging diode, was burned and shorted. So I replaced it with another one just for this test. This is the PCB that is in the toothbrush. It's all with SMD stuff on it, like this. Yes, and I mounted the battery. The battery is still okay, and I mounted the motor. And how you're gonna, if you have a problem with your toothbrush and you want to make it, they are not very expensive anymore today. At least the normal ones. There seems to be also toothbrushes with Bluetooth to show you how good you have brushed, but this is just a classic one. The first thing, if you want to open it, there are lots of videos about it. It is, you put this thing on the back of the charger, wireless charger, and you twist it a half turn, and then this part comes out, and then you can slide everything out. If you push it from the top, so you have to push the whole train out. I just cut it away because it was all hard from age. Then I made a schematic from first a drawing from the schematics from the PCB, how it looks like, so that is easier to measure. And then I made a schematic of it. I will keep it a bit in here, so you can, if you want, you can copy it. There are more teardowns of meters, and some also with parts of schematics, all schematics, and they're all reasonably the same if they are from Oral-B or Brown. They use different ICs, but the setup and the function is about the same. I could not find data sheets, but I found things out by measuring. This is a MOSFET. This is the thing that drives your motor. This is a sort of microprocessor timer thing. It has some intelligence at it, and it monitors something. If it is programmed, or it is a MOSCROM thing made in the factory only for this purpose, or only for one customer, I don't know, but it's not that important. And then the rest are some custom components. It is a wireless charger, so the in here is a the power supply, and normally you have a transformation. The transformation has two sides, like I drawn here, and here you excitate the primary, and that is done in this case with a 22 kilohertz signal, and then you have two parts of the transformer, and normally they are made in one piece, but here they are made in two pieces. So it's nothing special or nothing magical. So it is just they have cut the transformer in two halves and put some plastic in between it. So it's not no magical. So it is wireless, but in fact, it is not really wireless, because you have to connect them together. If I hold it like this and you look at the LED, then here it starts burning, and now it's making full contact. On the schematic, that is easier to see. Here's the transformer, And this is a transistor that's only used to detect if the thing is charging. Then here is a voltage on it, and the processor sees it. It sees that there is some action, and it turns on the LED. And this is the processor, the IC I had here. And this is the on-off button, so it reads the button, and if you press the button it goes on, and if you press it another time it goes slow, and third time it goes off. And if the motor has to run, then it switches on the MOSFET, and the motor is connected to earth from the battery to earth. It is a 1.5 volt motor. And then the motor starts turning, and they do that with the PWM signal, like we will see. The power supply, if the IC is powered from this part is a charger, but also powers the circuit. And what they do is it's a sort of push-pull action. They are out of phase, and that way they get a little bit higher efficiency, as opposed to only one side regulation of rectifying. And then it goes to a diode. It can go past the diode, and it goes to the VCC connections of the processor. And this is a snubber to damper things from the motor, and so so it feeds the microprocessor. The microprocessor turns on. It looks if it's in the charger. If it's in the charger, then the charge voltage, and so the current can go to the motor, can go to the battery too. The motor is switched off by the MOSFET, so if there is current, it goes to the battery. And if it's only on battery, the part is the other way. It goes to this diode, but can't go to that diode, so can't go back to the charger. So it powers the microprocessor. What if you want to charge? Then the microprocessor toggles this line on pin 3 and starts to PWM a transistor. And the transistor is bypassing those diodes. So here's 4.5 volts made from there, and here's 1.5, so the current flows from the high voltage to low voltage, no problems with the diodes in this case, and it charges the 1.5 battery. And the only thing is here, I cannot find something about the maximum charging. I know how much it charges, but I have not had the patience to wait what it will do if it is full, or it just keeps on charging. But this line is only the transistor, this line is only the charge transistor, this one is some internal function, this one is to the gate, and this one is to earth. So none of those can monitor the voltage on the power supply. The only thing that can do this is pin 8 or pin 6. So I think pin 6 is a sense voltage for the battery. I would have expected that they then put it to there, but the microprocessor needs is minimum voltage, so that's why I think they measure it between the diodes. So that voltage cannot be higher than the VCC, because if this is a sense, it must the voltage probably must be lower or the same as VCC at the max. So it is very simple, such a thing inside. But what if it's broken and you want to find the problem? First thing you can do is, if you have opened it, is test the battery. And that is not too hard. Just take your multimeter and check the voltage on it. And then you see this is a NICAT. And I put the meter a bit inside. If a NICAT is an NEMH possible. There's no text on it. And it's 1.37 volts. So probably this will be a 1.35 somewhere around there. Battery. The IC has, if the IC is what I think it has a minimum voltage that it can work on from 1 volt. So that it must be possible. Then, if the battery is okay, then there's a chance the charger is not okay. That it, if the battery is not okay, I mean, then it can be the battery or the charger. The testing the charger is simple if you have a current probe. Show that first. The middle wire here is the common. This line here that comes. I'm outside of the picture. This is this line. So now I measure the current at that position. Wrong way, and I will set it on the scope. In this scope, you will see the things you see now is not a charger, but it is my probe that is lying on top of the charger. Now I connect the coil, and then I have to put things a bit up. So, and I'll freeze the picture, and this is the thing that is happening, and I have written the data already here. It is pulsing, and then it waits, and then it's pulsing, and then it's waiting. The reason why, I do not know. Maybe it uses that so that if the current is dropping, that it can measure the battery or something like that. It's probably it's some sort of control mechanism. And everywhere in the circuit you see this current movement. So and voltage. So I will now put a voltage on it. Pause it so that you don't have to wait if I change everything. So this is the current that is going to the battery. So we saw the current that was coming from the charger after the double diode. So here, wait, it is here, and now we are measuring here. So if we measure the same current as there, a little bit less because the processor takes some current, then we know the charge transformer is okay. And if you look at the scope, I've paused it and I put the charge on, so don't have to wait on the triggering. Then you see that's the same kind of signal that was coming from the transformer. There is no stabilization. It is just a half wave rectified. You can see it there. You see the halfway bumps in there, and that is not a problem for a battery. The battery works as a sort of capacitor by himself. And then we here have the voltage, and that's the voltage measured on both sides of the transformer. So you're looking at the voltage. You're measuring at the voltage here, looking at the voltage here, and looking at the voltage there. At this side here and there. So in this case, we can see that both halves of the transformer are performing. So there's also another problem with the transformer. If I zoom out, then you see both faces are opposite. 1.5 volt power supply. Man, that is here. Often use this little tag of little hammer because it's a very handy thing. I've put it to 1.6 volts. it works fine at 1 volt too. And then we can, if we want to make it a bit educational and see the difference with how the IC do things. Now it's just plain DC we're running through the motor, and let me put it this here in the minus and plus. The resistor I put over the, let me see here, smart to see then, the power supply. The resistor I've placed over the motor was just because I first tested everything without a motor and I wanted to make a sort of circuit to do connect my probes with enough resistance so it will not influence things, because this is 2.7 mega ohms. So I just use it as a easy mounting point, like you do in Manhattan style soldering. Now I put the power on. Oh yeah, I was forgotten that already. The power supply cannot deliver enough power. I will take another one. It is not too bad that happened. My mistake with the enough current, because we measured the voltage of our battery, but it is possible that the battery shows 1.3 volts but has such a high inner resistance that it can't deliver enough current for the motor. And now I have a 1.5 power supply here that can deliver enough punch, and then if I connect it, it will run and it's drawing just around 500 milliamps on the meter of the power supply. But I also, that was outside of the picture, I captured on the scope, and then you see this is the signal that is driving the motor. It's not really the signal, because that is the, it is of course a steady 1.5 volt, but this is the current that it draws. It is a motor, so it works. It goes round. You can make a generator with a motor and then you get an AC voltage. So this is the response of the motor on the DC current. And to make it a bit more, did you believe me, I will show the voltage over the motor too. And I will make a setup for that. So I connected the probe over it, and the current probe was still in there. And now we see on the screen of the oscilloscope, we see in blue the voltage. And that is with a ripple on it, because the frequency is rather high and it's not one of the best power supplies, but it's good enough for this. And then you see it's just over 1.5 volt like the battery, and it's also drawing current from the battery normally. In this case it's just powered from the external supply, and the rest of the circuit has no function. The wires to the inductor are very fragile and very small. They're soldered to the PCB. So I made a header and I made a cable, and I glued this thing to the PCB, so everything stays stable and I'm not all tight trying to catch parts that will escape. So we have tested the battery, we have tested the motor, and we have tested the charger, and those are all okay, so theoretically it should run. But I've got another now. So we know how that works. Then what does the, we know what the post processor does. Zoom in a bit if that is working. This one here is the the microcontroller, the control chip in that case. And this one is the MOSFET. That is a MOSFET in a sort of IC package. The four on the top are the drain, the three on the bottom are the source, and the most right one is the gate. And here we got the little motor, the button you use to start the thing. There is something more. The motor won't run if the charger is connected. And it senses that probably on that line 6 too. So if it is charging, it won't tell the MOSFET that it should go to work. And another problem with this circuit was, I think, the little button here. Because when I tried to operate the thing at first, it was not working, and then suddenly it was working, it was not working. Sometimes the button did not react, sometimes it did. And so that makes it a bit harder to test things. Yeah, everything was okay. It is indeed the switch. I tried some things and maybe it works again. Now I turn it on, and then you see on the screen, you see the current that is drawn from the battery. In this case, I will pause it for next. And if we push another time, it goes over to half speed and then it goes off. So the whole thing is working now, but the problem is inside the switch. And it is normally a bit hard to find if you're not work systematic. So suppose I do not know at this moment it is switched. The first thing you then do is what we did just before. We know the charger is okay, the battery is okay, the motor itself is okay. So in this case, what must be bad, the IC could be bad, and then not driving the MOSFET. The MOSFET could be bad, but they most times go short, so in that case the motor won't stop turning and you get the tactile switch that can go bad. And for this sort of things, if you take a scope, I've taken the portable scope here because it's a bit more easy to read, I thought, but I don't know. I make this is the ground circuit, and I now decouple the motor. I will do that in fashion. No, this time it's not working again, so that is okay. That's what we want. We measure the battery. Okay, the battery voltage is 1.38, so that's fine. And then we have the voltage that is going that's coming from the power supply. So that is the common from the double diode. That's this one, top of my head now, must have D1, yeah, that was D1. Oh, stupid, I don't, I forgot to connect the charger. So then here we have the diode, and it's 1.8, it's not that high, but so it seems to do a bit of a current of charging control, because when I tried it yesterday, it was over 4.5 volts at that position. So the battery is more or less up to full charge now. But what we don't want to know is that was what we are trying. If we push the button, if we probe it down here, we get a negative and it's 2 volts, it's a bit high. Let's take it to 1 volt per division and then move it a bit up. So, and if we then look at the gate, then the gate is drawn negative in this case. It's a bit strange. Not that strange. If you take the wrong ground connection. So it's 0 volts now, and if we then push the tactile switch, there is no reaction. And if we put the switch itself, that is the one contact of the switch, this is the 0 side, and this is probably the high side, yes. If I now push that button, it should connect this point to ground, and it does that. So it is not the switch that is not working with at this moment. Okay, wrong again. It is working. It was still on the charger. But if the switch was not working and had a problem, then we would not have seen the trace dipping back to 0. So without the soldering or measuring the resistance, we now know that the switch is okay. And then we have the same thing we can do at the gate. This is the gate of the MOSFET here. And you see, and it's a bit strange, I don't know why it's doing that, but every now and then it is giving a very short pulse on the gate, maybe to keep some current to the motor, to do something with the battery or so, I don't know, because it is almost nothing. And if we don't measure what happens, if we measure on the drain, then you see I hope you can see it, because I can't see in this monitor if it's all a bit too much light and so that sort of things. Now you must be able to see it. Yes, you see there is also a small reaction from the MOSFET. So this is the gate, and this is the current going to the motor, through the motor. So the motor does not work, but there is some kind of circuit. And if I decouple the motor, you see the signal also it goes away. I have to find it again. There. So in this case, we know the. It is trying to keep things a bit alive or so. No clue why. It is because there's no data sheet of this thing. And also notice that it does it sometimes. It does that sometimes, it does that not. And now we have the same problem as we had before, because now the tactile switch is not responding anymore. So the mistake can be somewhere in this area. And now if we put the trace, you see the what I did before, I have the trace, and if I push the switch, then the switch drops, but we only have 1.6 volts now here, and that's a lot less as we had while the battery voltage is still 1.5 volt. So there are more things not completely fine here. And if I put it on the charger and then probe the gate, there's nothing. I probe the drain. It's just the high voltage we would expect. So that is okay. And here we have the gate again, and that is low. And now it's some kind of click. If we then try the button, now we have a higher voltage on the tactile switch. And then it goes down if we push it. So there are some things, and now I have the motor charger removed and it works again. So at the time it is not working, the voltage we measure on the top of the tactile switch is too low. It now is almost no, just over 2 volts. And if I and now we have a working motor again. So there's not much sense in finding the complete fault, because the meter is of the meter, the toothbrush is not usable anymore. But this is just some ways to let you see what you can do and how you can reverse engineer such a thing and test what it is like, the probing of the tactile switch. Yeah, something anyone can do, and then look what it does. And now you got, we are lucky. You see, now I put my probe on it and we have again the 0.6 volts or so. And if I now pull the button, it goes down, but things are not starting. So what is making, what is the problem? And now we know some things. We know that here we measure, if the thing works, we measure almost 2 volts on this location, and if the thing doesn't work, we measure around 0.6 or 7 volts, and then it does not work. And how does it get that voltage? It gets that voltage from the microprocessor. But what happens there? If the voltage there fluctuates, the microprocessor cannot start up. So that is done, is in this case the next step. And then we have 0.6 and 0.8. 0.8 is the one here at the end, and we see there is a voltage of 1 point, just as low as that the other was. I will put it on the zero line, so it is exactly 1 volt. And if we then push the thing, nothing happens. What if we put the charger on it? Then you see the voltage on the controller is just over 3 volts, and it won't run because the charger is connected. But now I have removed the charger and the voltage there is 2 volts, and I push the button a few times and it drops to 1 volt. So why is that voltage dropping to 1 volt? Is it the battery? So probe the battery. The battery is 1.5 volts and it is going pin 6 and 8. Yeah, and that's the voltage drop of the diode. So that seems to be okay on the top side here. So the processor maybe makes some kind of voltage inside. Because if it's running the motor, it's always on the battery. So there is the 1 volt on pin H is perfectly normal. That's the volt drop of the diode. that's the short key here. So we have here the voltage from the charge and normally from the battery, that's 1.3 volts, and then we have the double short key, so here we measure about 1 volt. But with 1 volt the toothbrush is not working. And the only thing we have seen at this moment is that in that case there is a difference in voltage on the button there, and that voltage is made inside of the IC here, and that can be just still a problem with dirt or oxide. It switches, but maybe the resistance, the inner resistance, is too high, because you see it switching, but it's only 1.8 volts or so on the above the switch, and when it was high enough, then it did run. And if we push the button and we measure just the battery voltage, you see there's not much happening there. You can't see it, sorry. There's not much happening on the scope. So it is not the battery that can't deliver the power in this case. So the motor is okay because it was running. The MOSFET is okay because it was running, and it's not that the MOSFET is trying to switch. There is no signal on the gate of the MOSFET, and that signal on the gate is made by that controller IC, and it is responding. It is pulled down to zero by the button. The button works like we have seen. It's not that there needs to be a lot of current, and so the thing that is left over is the IC. In this case, the IC must have a problem, or some solder joint or so to the IC. What it exactly is not the most important part. These are just difficult things to find, because the fault is not always there. Well, in a strange way it is also easy, because now we can measure what it supposed to do if that is working. When it was working, we did see that we had a higher voltage above the button, and that was the only change we could see. So if it is running with that higher voltage, then probably that voltage is too low, and it must be 1 volt, or it was higher, but you don't know the minimum voltage that it needs. Maybe the minimum voltage is just 200 millivolts higher or something like that. And that was also a problem with this meter. Of with this meter, I work too much on meters. With this toothbrush, when it was running, you could not turn it off. And then when you want to turn it off, I put it on the charger, and then it stopped, because that is a function of the processor. And so that worked, but at the last it would not start every time. And now we see that is we have now the same problem here. And the only thing that is left at this moment is the controller IC, because it needs to make a voltage on the gate to turn the gate open. And we don't have that voltage. And then if we looked, and now we see the little pulse on the gate again. It is also a bit strange. Then there is a chance that it is now running again. Yes, it's running again. And if it's okay, then probably that should do it. And now we have a much higher voltage there on the top of the IC, on the top of the switch. And I think it is the power supply, the battery only makes 1.5 volt. So it is possible there is some sort of converter in the in the processor itself that makes that higher voltage, and it does it sometimes and it does sometimes not. And it is after a bit of charging, so it looks like it is keeping some charge and it is working on that. In either case, it's now, it's also not running every with the same speed every time. And yeah, now we have the little gate signal, and then if we start it, then you see we have the duty cycle system. Stop it. And now you see on the scope, while it was running, you see the signal, the PWM signal, that it was controlling the gate, and it's almost full on, so that can be correct because it's running at full speed at this moment. And yeah, the question is, what is really wrong somewhere in that IC? And yeah, you can't get in there, and besides that, I don't think you can get the ICs, and probably it's also not worth the troubles to try to fix it. But hey, I like fixing things, and it just also things that you can't fix or not supposed to fix. In this case, it was just a nice thing to make a video about troubleshooting in a circuit and seeing how a toothbrush worked. And now we still have the high voltage on the button, and we can switch it on and off. And there is something that is, if I disconnect the battery, then that voltage on top of the switch stays 1 volt, and it is now slowly dropping. So I think it holds its charge inside the IC for a long while. And if I now connect the battery back, then it is not running. So it is definitely a problem in the IC itself. And if we then now charge it a little bit, now we have the high voltage, but still not working because the loader is connected, and our loader is gone, and we have the high signal, and now it's running again. So the only thing that can go wrong in this case is the controller IC, and it seems to work for a part. There are two capacitors inside. This one is from a snubber, so that, well, I forgot to look if I may. This one is from the snubber, so that can do it. And this is between those two pins. I have no clue what the function of that capacitor is. I think it is just a timing capacitor that sets the frequency for the motor. And the motor is running around 900 up to 1500 kilohertz, and the whole power supply, the charger, is running at 22 kilohertz. So now you know it all, and maybe it helps you if you want. They have to fix your own toothbrush. So, hope you liked it, and till the next video. Bye bye.